Now next is pharmaceutical. See, India's pharmaceutical industry has established a global reputation for quality and affordable prices. Basically, pharma export from India account for 10% of the global export by volume. In terms of volume, India accounts for 10% of the global market and it is ranked third in the world in terms of volume of export. But in terms of value, India's pharma export account for 1.4% of the global market and India ranks 10th in the world. Why? Because our pharma products are very cheap. So we are the bulk supplier to the developing country. India is the pharmacy of developing world. In bulk, in volume, we are third largest. We account for 10% of the pharma goods exported in the world, pharma market. But in terms of value, India's pharma exports account for 1.4% by value. We stand 10th. At present, the pharma export of the country are about $10 billion at present. The industry is expected to expand at a compound annual growth rate of 14.5%. And it is over the period of 2010 to 2020, the pharma exports are expected to increase at a compound annual growth rate of 14.5%. And it is expected that by 2020, the pharma exports will be about $55 billion. See, our pharma exports have been dominated by generics. For this, let us go to the background. What are generics? Basically, before 1970, India was having the highest prices of drugs because most of the drugs that were sold in India, they were the branded drugs. That is, those persons who were having the patents over the drugs, they were selling the drugs. So the drug prices in India was one of the highest in the world before 1970. In 1970, Indian Patent Act 1970 enabled process patenting. That is, the same patented product could be produced by way of different process. The same patented product could be manufactured by way of different process. Now, this enabled number of Indian companies which have having huge chemistry skills, they started producing the same product, patented product by way of different process, because India's patent law enabled it. These drugs are known as generics, because branded drugs are those drugs that is those manufacturers which those who innovate, they put into research and development for tens of years and thereby they innovate a new thing, that those are branded drugs. But in India, the same drug after 1970, what happened? The same patented drug could be manufactured by a different process, because this act introduced process patenting. As a result, drug prices in India became one of the lowest in the country. And India, these are known as generic drugs or unbranded drugs, which are manufactured by way of different process, the same patented drug. Now, India started exporting drugs to developing countries. The prices of these generic drugs were very low as compared to branded drugs. For example, you can say for HIV AIDS medicines in Africa, the branded drugs cost $12,000 per year and Indian generic drugs cost just $120 per year. As compared to branded drugs, Indian drugs were, generic drugs are very cheap, and therefore India is known as pharmacy of developing world. Now, our pharma exports have been dominated by generic drugs. This continued up to 2005. In 2005, according to trade-related intellectual property right, TRIPS agreement of WTO, India had to pass Patent Amendment Act 2005. In this amendment act, we introduce product patenting. Now, we cannot, now the generic drug manufacturers in India cannot manufacture the branded drug by way of different process until the patent expires. Either the patent expires, then they can manufacture the same drug, or if patent is there, now we have, by way of patent amendment act, we have accepted product patent. If any innovation is given a patent in India, then basically generic manufacturers cannot manufacture that drug unless and until that patent expires. Once the patent expires, then the generic manufacturers can manufacture the drug. But here in Patent Amendment Act 2005, there is a section 3D we will discuss, which makes the patent very difficult. Suppose a manufacturing company, suppose a pharma company in US has patented a drug. According to trade related intellectual property rights, there are three conditions: that drug should be new, it should be capable of application, and for in other purposes, three conditions are there. But Indian Patent Amendment Act introduces fourth condition also, that is enhanced efficacy. So in India, a drug can be registered as a patent. Any innovation can get patent only if it fulfills all the four conditions, and therefore it becomes very difficult for any innovation or patented drug in US to get patent in India. And this is the clause that we will discuss in detail. So now, after Patent Amendment Act 2005, we have introduced patent product patenting. But in India, for an innovation to get a patent, it is difficult because our conditions are much more stringent than WTO or trade-related intellectual property rights. What they are prescribing, even compared to them, our standards are higher in this field. Now, what happens, since it becomes very difficult for any patent holder, because they will have to fulfill all the four conditions to get patent in India. So right now, it is benefiting Indian industry, because since they don't get the patent, so our generic manufacturer continue to manufacture the same patented drug, because that patented drug is not getting patent in India, because India's conditions are much more rigid. But trade, it is not in violation of WTO, we'll discuss. Why? Because WTO TRIPS agreement provides the bare minimum need that these minimum requirements should be there for an innovation to get patent. India has added one more requirement. It has not lowered the standard, it has raised it. But in future, when India's companies will start innovating, investing in research and development to innovate a new drug, then they will face the same problem, because WTO says this patent regime should be same for innovations outside as well as within the country. Right now, we are not investing in research and development. We are not giving the patent to the innovations that are done abroad. But in future, when our own industry will involve in research and development, then that innovation will also be, that will become difficult for that innovation to get patent in India, because our own standards are high. So we will discuss this aspect. So this was a brief history. Now, India presently, the innovations or drugs which are innovated abroad, they don't get patent in India easily. Why? Because our standards are high and the generic manufacturers continue to manufacture the drugs. Trade related intellectual property right also offers some relaxation to any country, that is of compulsory licensing and parallel import. Suppose in any public health concern arises in any country, then that country has the right to override the patent and give a compulsory license to any local manufacturer to manufacture that drug, right? By giving a lump sum compensation to the patent holder. Or if you are not having any manufacturer in your country, then you can import the same drug from any other country where the prices are low. That is parallel import. These two provisions are mentioned in trade-related intellectual property right itself. Now, Indian generic drugs, our pharma exports have been dominated by generics, that is unbranded drugs. We don't invest in research and development. Rather, the same drug is manufactured by different process, because that drug is not patented in India. That drug does not get the patent status in India. with manufacture with many drugs having basically certain drugs go off patent after a certain period. The patent expires. Once the patent expires, that drug can be manufactured by the Indian generic drug manufacturers. Now, basically, even the developed countries like USA and European Union, they are bulk importer of India's generic drug, so that they may have the benefit of cheap cost. They also import from India. Basically, there is a shift in the developed market, basically towards generic, and therefore there is more prospect for the generic drug manufacturers. Because what happens in developed countries like Europe, they are facing fiscal problem, and wherever public health is a major charge on national exchequer, basically solution will have to be found in the form of import of generic drugs. So it basically they have to rely upon generic drugs. The US and European Union also import generic drugs because they are cheap. Now basically patented or branded drugs are very costly. Now there are certain issues that need to be addressed in this sector, in pharmaceutical sector. Now what happens, our pharma are generic drugs, cheapest drugs. We are expert at manufacturing cheapest drug. The chemistry skills are unparalleled. But China, Japan, in these market we are not getting adequate market access. These issues need to be addressed. That is, as for example in Japan, what is the issue that need to be assessed? Access to Japanese market remain constrained by non-tariff barrier. Basically, what are non-tariff barrier? I will discuss elaborately. Non-tariff barriers, basically these are those barriers which are apart from tariff. Non-tariff barriers are any measures other than high import duty that makes your the import of any product difficult. That is, non-tariff barriers are any other form of barrier apart from raising the import duty which makes the import difficult. Non-tariff barrier refers to restrictions, conditions or specific market requirement that makes the import of any product difficult. Non-tariff barrier also include unjustified or improper application of non-tariff measures like sanitary and phytosanitary measures or technical barriers to trade. Their unjustified application is also non-tariff barrier. Non-tariff barrier arises from different measures taken by any government in the form of laws, regulation, policies, conditions, restrictions, basically or specific requirement to protect its domestic industry from foreign competition. Now, non-tariff barriers may include product basically specific quotas. It may include complex discriminatory rules of origin. It may include quality condition imposed by importing country. Non-tariff barrier may include complex regulatory environment. Non-tariff barrier may also include unjustified sanitary and phytosanitary measures. Now, basically in Japan, it is the non-tariff barriers that are the major obstacle for India's access, for the access of India's pharma products. Japan is world's second largest pharma market. Japan is world's second largest pharma market, and India's pharma not even has a 1% share in Japanese pharma market. Our share is less than 1%. Basically, even after implementing comprehensive free trade agreement with Japan, we are having comprehensive economic partnership agreement. Even after implementing a comprehensive free trade deal with Japan, Indian pharma sector faces procedural issues. There are certain procedural issues like tedious registration process in Japan. Basically, this is what tedious registration process. It is NTBs, non-tariff barriers, that is hindering India's access to Japan's pharma market. In China, the pharma companies face regulatory hurdles. In China, the India's pharma companies face regulatory hurdles in the form of prolonged and unpredictable timelines for registering Indian drugs. Basically, this has adversely impacted India's expansion plans
इन फार्मा सेक्टर इन चाइना बेसिकली ऑन एन एवरेज रजिस्ट्रेशन इन चाइना टेक्स 3 to 4 years एज कंपेयर टू लेस देन 10 months इन इंडिया फॉर फार्मा कंपनी. बेसिकली द चाइनीज ड्रग रेगुलेटर रिक्वायर दैट द कंपनी प्लानिंग टू रजिस्टर इट्स प्रोडक्ट इन चाइना टू नॉट ओनली रिवील दैट कंपनी हैज नॉट ओनली टू रिवील द डिटेल्ड प्रोसेस ऑफ मैन्युफैक्चर बट इट हैज ऑल्सो टू कंडक्ट क्लिनिकल ट्रायल्स विद इन चाइना विच हैज डेटर्ड नंबर ऑफ इंडियाज फार्मा एक्सपोर्टर्स टू गो इन टू द चाइनीज मार्केट. एक तो रजिस्ट्रेशन करने में 3 साल लग जाते हैं, फिर वो कहते हैं डिटेल में बताओ कैसा मैन्युफैक्चरिंग प्रोसेस कैसी है, फिर क्लिनिकल ट्रायल्स भी करो. तो इतनी बेसिकली इंडियन फार्मा मैन्युफैक्चरर्स आर नॉट इंटरेस्टेड, इट इज अ वेरी डिलेड टाइम. अपार्ट फ्रॉम दीज फार्मा सेक्टर इज ऑल्सो विसिट बाय नंबर ऑफ चैलेंजेस. मोस्ट ऑफ दीज चैलेंजेस अराइज आउट ऑफ एनवायरबल. लोग चिड़ करके इंडिया को बदनाम और करते हैं बिकॉज ऑफ enviable reputation of India as a reliable supplier of generic medicines. इससे लोग जलन भी तो होती है ना, because India is providing very cheap medicines. What are these challenges? Let us see what are these challenges. पहला, there are false campaigns to malign the generic products. In some geographies of the world, false campaigns are being launched to malign the generic products that Indian generic medicines are in violation of India's intellectual property rights commitment. ये कहते हैं कि India's generic products are in violation of India's commitment to intellectual property rights commitment. तो ये तो बताओ India का intellectual property right commitment है क्या? अरे भाई under section 3D we have very rigid norms for any innovation in pharma sector outside India or inside India to get patent in India. According to section 3D of Patent Amendment Act 2005, section 3D of Patent Amendment Act 2005 has established very stringent norms with respect to obtaining pharma patent in India. And second, they also allege that India has a propensity of giving compulsory licensing. There was a provision in TRIPS that a country can give compulsory license to any company in case of public health concern if the patented drug holder is unwilling to bring down its prices. But India has given a single compulsory license. It is false. Only one compulsory license has been given. India does not frequently resort to compulsory licensing. It is false allegation. Now, what India has done in 2005, when India introduced product patenting, then India also set the standard that if all these standards are met, only then that innovated drug will get the patentability in India. Now, Section 3D sets in any invention threshold that is higher than TRIPS. Section 3D of Patent Amendment Act 2005 has set the invention threshold higher than TRIPS. This 3D mandates that patentable invention, TRIPS ne kya kaha, according to TRIPS, any innovation can get the patent. According to TRIPS, any innovation can get the patent if it fulfills 3 conditions. First, the innovation must be new. Second, it should involve any inventive step. Innovation should involve any inventive step. And third, it must be capable of industrial application. If these 3 parameters are met, the innovation in pharma sector can get patent. But the Section 3D of Patent Amendment Act 2005 adds a 4th condition. It has also added a 4th condition, that is enhanced efficacy. Apart from these 3, the 4th condition should also be met for any innovation in the field of pharma to get patentability in India. Otherwise, that patent will not be held valid in India. And therefore, America is very against this. Why India is raising the standard? It should be according to the global rules. But it is not violation of TRIPS. TRIPS has just mandated the bare minimum requirement. We have raised the standard. although in short run it is difficult for any, because we are not investing in research and development. America, it is a, most of the patents belong to America. Right now, we are having the benefit that generic manufacturer can continue to manufacture the drug, because a patented drug in America will not get the patentability in India. But later on, when we will start research and development, then we will also have to fulfill this fourth condition. Then it will become a deterrent for innovation and research and development in India itself. Now, this Section CD Act adds a fourth condition, that is enhanced efficacy, in addition to the three conditions prescribed by TRIPS. And this fourth condition has been upheld by India's judiciary. Basically, so India has been exhorted to bring its patentability. India has been forced to bring its patentability on par with international norms. अमेरिका कहता है भाई इंटरनेशनल नॉर्म्स के हिसाब से लाओ. नाउ इंटरनेशनल नॉर्म्स क्या है? ट्रिप्स ने किसके हिसाब से नॉर्म्स रखे हैं? अमेरिका के हिसाब से नहीं, हर जगह अमेरिका को स्टैंडर्ड मान लिया जाता है. फेडरेशन तो अमेरिका की इंडिया, कुछ बेवकूफ लोग इंडिया को क्वासी फेडरल कहते हैं. व्हाई? बिकॉज इंडियन फेडरेशन सेंटर इज मोर पावरफुल एज कंपेयर टू यूएस. अरे यूएस तो इंडिपेंडेंट स्टेट्स थे, और दोज इंडिपेंडेंट कंट्रीज सरेंडर्ड अ पार्ट ऑफ देयर सॉवरेनिटी टू फॉर्म अ कंट्री. देयरफॉर द सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट इज हैविंग लेस पावर एंड कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट स्टेट्स आर हैविंग मोर पावर. इंडिया में केस दूसरा था, एक यूनिटरी कंट्री था जिसमें हमने स्टेट्स कार्व आउट किए थे. देयरफॉर द रेस्ट्री पावर द मोर पावर बिलोंग टू सेंटर. सिंस in our federation the center is stronger, so it is quasi federal because it does not fit to the parameter of American federation. वैसे ही patent medicines में TRIPS ने जो agreement माना है वो अमेरिका के norms के basis माना है. The American norms are international norms. No, we can have much more better norms, and we are having. Basically, so India is being forced to bring its patentability on par with international norms. Now, international norms refers to patentability standards styled after US. International norms refer to, basically, now international norms refer to patentability standards styled after US model. In fact, Section 3D is compatible with TRIPS related intellectual property rights. It is not incompatible, it is compatible. TRIPS of WTO, it creates a broad framework of minimum standard. That is, three minimum conditions should be fulfilled. It never says you can fulfill even more conditions. These three minimum conditions should be fulfilled to get the patentability. In fact, Article 27 of TRIPS delineates the broad conditions under which any nation may exclude any invention from patentability. That is, it accepts the nation's ability to exclude the grant of patent to any invention. Yes, if it is necessary to protect human, animal or plant life or health, a nation can exclude. So it is clear that TRIP trade related intellectual property rights agreement afford the member nations a substantial degree of flexibility to formulate their patentability standard. And India has, every nation has the right to set the patentability standard to best suit their nation, so that it best suits their national conditions, provided they are enforced without discrimination as to the place of invention. जो standards यूने सेट किए हैं, आपने सेट किए हैं, those should be applicable to your domestic industry also. You cannot have discrimination with foreign invention and domestic invention. So later phase we may face problem. But अभी जो false campaign कर रहे हैं लोग कि basically Indian generic drugs are not in line with the commitment of India's intellectual property rights. उनको ठीक से यही नहीं मालूम है what is India's commitment to intellectual property rights. Our patents, our generic drugs are basically within the framework of India's intellectual property rights. This is intellectual property right. Patent means intellectual property rights. Second, alleged lack of compliance. कहते हैं कि भाई इंडिया की जेनरिक मेडिसिन क्वालिटी नहीं होती है. अब बताए, दे एलेज देयर इज लैक ऑफ कंप्लायंस ऑफ जेनरिक मेडिसिंस कमिंग आउट ऑफ इंडिया विद क्वालिटी स्टैंडर्ड. दूसरा एलिगेशन लगाते हैं इंडिया से मेडिसिन जो आती है वो क्वालिटी नहीं होती है, झूठ। इन 2011 अ कंसाइनमेंट वॉज सीज्ड इन अफ्रीका, अ फार्मास्यूटिकल कंसाइनमेंट वॉज सीज्ड बाय द अफ्रीकन अथॉरिटी, दे फाउंड दैट फार्मास्यूटिकल कंसाइनमेंट वॉज सब स्टैंडर्ड, दैट फार्मास्यूटिकल कंसाइनमेंट वॉज डिस्पैच्ड फ्रॉम चाइना बट इट वॉज मार्क्ड विद मेक इन इंडिया। इंडिया इमीडिएटली टुक अप दिस इशू विद अफ्रीकन अथॉरिटीज एंड चाइना एंड प्रूव्ड इट बियॉन्ड डाउट दैट इट इज अ फॉल्स कैंपेन, दे वर द चाइनीज मैन्युफैक्चरर्स हु वर यूजिंग द इंडियन नेम एंड ब्रांड टू एक्सपोर्ट देयर सब स्टैंडर्ड मटीरियल, एंड आफ्टर दिस डायरेक्टर जनरल ऑफ फॉरन ट्रेड हैज एंश्योर्ड अ सर्वेलेंस सिस्टम नोन एज ट्रेस एंड ट्रैक सिस्टम, दिस आई विल डिस्कस। Trace and track system has been enforced since this, after this. Basically, under trace and track system, the consumer who is consuming the medicine, he can trace the original manufacturer who has manufactured it. So now, China ne kya kiya manum? Made in India, both. You know, Chinese products, always secondary, they just used the stamp of India, and that was, Chinese authorities subsequently told India that they have taken criminal assault measures on those exporters. But that was an attempt to malign the image of India. So they alleged that India's generic medicine lacked the quality. That is false. Next challenge. India is not a party to Pharmaceutical Inspection Convention. India is not a party to Pharmaceutical Inspection Convention and Pharmaceutical Inspection Cooperation Scheme. This India has said, yes, soon we will get the membership. India is not party to Pharmaceutical Inspection Convention and Pharmaceutical Inspection Cooperation Scheme. And Indian Pharmacopoeia means drug making, is not recognized yet in major markets. Yes, this is true. India is not member of this Pharmaceutical Inspection Convention. Therefore, pharmacopoeia means the art of drug making. Because India is not member of this, so India's drug making is yet not recognized in number of major markets, countries. India's next issue challenge is India's pricing policy. इंडिया के एक्सपोर्टर कहते हैं द प्राइसिंग पॉलिसी इज सो लो दैट द मार्जिन्स ऑफ प्रॉफिट आर लेस, बट दैट इज द स्ट्रेंथ, दैट इज वेयर द वी प्ले द गेम। इंडियाज प्राइसिंग पॉलिसीज दैट फोर्स इंडियाज एक्सपोर्टर टू प्राइस देयर प्रोडक्ट्स विद एक्सट्रीमली लो मार्जिन्स, बट दैट इज द स्ट्रेंथ इंडिया इज हैविंग। सो ऑल दीज चैलेंजेस हैव बीन मेट फ्रंटली बाय द गवर्नमेंट इन एरियाज ऑफ इंटेलेक्चुअल प्रॉपर्टी राइट्स। The challenges have been addressed at international forums by filling disputes and challenging any wrongful treatment that is meted to India's medicines. We have challenged these issues in international forum, basically by filing disputes and all, and any wrongful treatment that is meted to India's medicines, this is challenged. Quality related compliance, in terms of quality related compliance, issues has been addressed by in promoting self-discipline in quality. Yes, this issue has been addressed by promoting self-discipline and dealing with all ill-intentioned campaigns against Indian medicines. Some campaigns are ill-intentioned and they have to be tackled. And secondly, on our own part, we have to maintain the self-discipline. In fact, India is the first country to adopt trace and track policy. What I discussed, चाइना ने क्या किया था, इंडिया के नाम पे भेज दिया था। सो इंडिया दिस विल बी वेरी बेनिफिशियल। इंडिया इज द फर्स्ट कंट्री टू अडॉप्ट ट्रेस एंड ट्रेक पॉलिसी और ट्रेस एंड ट्रैक सर्वेलेंस सिस्टम फॉर ऑल मेडिसिनल प्रोडक्ट एक्सपोर्टेड बाय इट ग्लोबली फ्रॉम 1 April 2015। वी हैव अडॉप्टेड दिस। नाउ दिस ट्रेस एंड ट्रैक सर्वेलेंस सिस्टम वुड ऑफर कंज्यूमर an opportunity to track the movement of products up to their manufacturer. They can trace their manufacturer and thereby establish their originality. This will be a deterrent against mischief likely to be done by exporters from other countries as well as some unprincipled or unscrupulous exporters within the country. They will be tracked. This trace and track system is in order to basically reassert India's claim. This objective is to reassert the objective of adopting trace and track system is to reassert India's claim as a credible generic pharma supplier and at the same time to mandate an internal discipline upon exporting community. The exporting community would remain aware because of this trace and track system. As regards pricing, while challenge is daunting, no doubt, we keep our drugs very low. It is also recognized that this is the factor that makes India's medicine affordable and so popular. It is important for India to work towards membership of Pharmaceutical Inspection Convention so that India's this drug making is accepted by major markets. So this was all about pharmaceutical sector. India is having huge potential in this sector. Next is light manufacturing. Light manufacturing, this includes leather manufacturing, textiles, all these aspects. Leather products and textile products. Now, this is another important category that needs to grow. An important category that needs to grow is that of export based on light manufacturing sector. This light export based on light manufacturing sector needs to grow because they are labor intensive. Leather and textile both are labor intensive, and once these exports will grow, that will lead to creation of employment. These are important. Light manufacturing, the two important components are leather and textiles. Leather and textiles. Basically, leather and textiles are the two most important components in light manufacturing. These are important because they generate employment as well as they have high value addition. Now, and these have historically been India's strength in export. Basically, they are the traditional areas where India was having the strength. First is leather. Vellore in Tamil Nadu accounts for 40% of total export of the country. Export. Leather sector is major employment creating sector. India already has significant name in footwear. Joote chappal mein India ka naam hai. Additional focus is required for leather garment manufacturing. Ab kapde lete hi banao, matlab joote chappal bana liye, now there is additional focus is required for leather garment manufacturing and export. We need to diversify the products. अब तक हमारा जूट एक्सपोर्ट कम क्यों था? क्यों रस्सी और बोरे ही बनाते थे? जब से जूट से थैले और कमीज पैंट सब बनने लगे, जूट का एक्सपोर्ट बढ़ गया है. यू नीड टू डाइवर्सिफाई योर प्रोडक्ट रेंज. वंस यू डाइवर्सिफाई योर प्रोडक्ट रेंज, योर एक्सपोर्ट्स विल ऑटोमेटिकली गो अप. सो इन फुटवेयर वी आर हैविंग द स्ट्रेंथ. नाउ गारमेंट सेक्टर, लेदर गारमेंट्स शुड ऑल्सो बी मैन्युफैक्चर्ड एंड दे शुड बी एक्सपोर्टेड. नाउ नेक्स्ट इज टेक्सटाइल्स. In textiles, we need to realize more effectively the scope for growth made possible. See, in textile sector, the scope of growth has increased after the dismantling of multi-fiber agreement, that is quota regime. Since 1974, there was quota regime. This regime, every country's quota was fixed. It continued till 1994. Since 1995, this quota regime began to be tapered, and by 2005, this quota regime was completely abolished. There was a multi-fiber agreement. Actually, what was the scene? In textiles, in developing countries, cheap labor is there. So the textile manufactured by developing countries is cheap. So developed country textile is costly. So they put the quota regime to protect their own industry. that this quota regime was to protect their own industry, and a quota for specific for every country, a specific quota was fixed. Now this was for a particular period. डेवलप कंट्री ने कहा भाई देखो हमारे यहाँ टेक्सटाइल महंगा है, तुम्हारे यहाँ चीप होता है, ऐसे ही तुम फ्लड कर दो कि हमारे मार्केट को, तो हमारा मार्केट खत्म हो जाएगा. तो डेवलप कंट्री ने हाथ पैर जोड़े, तो डेवलपिंग कंट्री ने ठीक है कोटा रेजिम. दिस वाज आल्सो बेनिफिशियल टू सर्टेन लीस्ट डेवलप्ड कंट्रीज बिकॉज दोज वर गेटिंग फिक्स्ड कोटास, दे वर गेटिंग एसेस ऑफ अ पर्टिकुलर कोटा टू डेवलप्ड कंट्रीज मार्केट. डेवलपिंग कंट्रीज वर गेटिंग फिक्स्ड कोटा टू अ डेवलप्ड कंट्रीज मार्केट and developed countries were assured that we will not export import more than this fixed quota, so they were also protecting their domestic industry. Now the phasing out began from 1995, phasing out of quota, and by 2005 this multi-fiber agreement of quota regime is totally abolished. Now there is no quota, now it is truly open market according to WTO norms. Now multi-fiber agreement that imposed quota on amount that developing country could export to developed country. Now with the dismantling of this quota regime, there is huge scope for India's textile to increase. With over 45 million people employed directly in textile sector, and the apparel industry is one of the largest source of employment in India. It is labor intensive industry. 45 लाख से ज्यादा लोग डायरेक्टली एम्प्लॉयड हैं, एंड अपैरल इंडस्ट्री इज वन ऑफ द मेजर प्रोवाइडर ऑफ एम्प्लॉयमेंट. सो द लेबर इंटेंसिटी ऑफ अपैरल इंडस्ट्री इज वन ऑफ द हाईएस्ट, एंड एज अ नेट एक्सपोर्टर ऑफ कॉटन यार्न, इंडिया इज अ नेट एक्सपोर्टर ऑफ कॉटन यार्न, सो इंडिया इज हैविंग सिग्निफिकेंट एडवांटेज ओवर इट्स कॉम्पिटिटर्स लाइक चाइना. हम तो नेट यार्न एक्सपोर्ट करते हैं, and as we add value to it, we can export apparels also. India has the strength. India is having the largest area in the world under cotton, and India basically is net exporter of yarn. The day we start value addition and instead of yarn we start exporting garments, this will further increase the scope of export. So in this regard we have advantage over our competitors like China and Bangladesh. Because we have the space of moving up the value chain. The textile and garment sector has traditionally been a leader of India's exports in global market, particularly to the traditional market of USA and European Union. Are these textile exports were mostly destined towards US and European Union. While textile continues to be an important sector, it has come up against several challenges. What are those? These challenges need to be reoriented itself in view of this sector, textile sector ke samne kai challenge aa gaye. As a result, the textile sector need to reorient itself in view of emerging challenges and emerging opportunities. Several developing countries are becoming major competitors of India in garment sector. AMNO Textile Upgradation Fund scheme, government is launching, textile parks are being established. So government is also pushing up, basically by way of Textile Upgradation Fund scheme, TUFs, by way of textile parks, because number of countries are becoming India's competitor. The foreign trade policy recognizes the employment creating potential as well as the potential of textile sector as value addition. It has both the potential, that is of creating employment as well as value adding. India basically, this Coimbatore, Tirupur and Erode in Tamil Nadu, it accounts for 55% export of knitwear, that is known as textile value of country. So government is having special focus on textile. Why? Two reasons. It has huge potential for employment generation, and it has huge potential for value addition. So this was all about textiles. This multi-fiber agreement is clear. So after the dismantling of this multi-fiber agreement regime, you should always bear in mind it was a protectionist measure by the developed countries to prevent their market being flooded by cheap goods of developing countries. But for developing countries, it fixed quotas. So the developing countries, some of the least developed countries also had the right of access to these markets. but now it has been dismantled. The other sector is, which is very important, employment, basically labor intensive, that is gems and jewelry sector. See, gems and jewelry sector is, although it is labor intensive like textile, but the value addition in textile is far more as compared to gems and jewelry sector. Gems and jewelry sector. It is also labor intensive, but the value addition in gems and jewelry is less as compared to textile. Gems and jewelry is another important labor intensive export sector. We import the raw gems and after finishing it, we export it. It is another labor intensive export sector that needs to be encouraged. This sector has relatively low value addition as compared to textiles, but contributes high volume of export. The volume of export is very high. Although it has low value addition, but it contributes to very high volume of exports and employment, and therefore it is important. The gems and jewelry manufacturing sector largely consists of small and medium enterprises unit, small and medium enterprises unit employing skilled and semi-skilled labor. These SMEs, small and medium enterprises, are mostly engaged in gems and jewelry sector, and they employ skilled and semi-skilled labor, almost entirely in unorganized sector. Mostly they are in unorganized sector. This sector is not only a major source of revenue generation, but is also a source of employment. This sector employs skilled workforce of 3.5 million, that is 35 lakh. Gems and jewelry exports have increased strongly. From $29 in 2009-10, the export of gems and jewelry has increased to $42 billion in 2013-14. In 9-10, our export was $29 billion and 2013-14, our export was $42 billion. Basically, the share of gem and jewelry sector in India's total merchandise export was 13.3%. Huge. Basically, but this sector is import based. We import the gems to finish it and then re-export it. Now, basically this is import based export. Gems and jewelry, this sector is import based export. This sector has been included under the Make in India initiative. Gems and jewelry sector has been included in Make India initiative, and gems and jewelry sector is, since it is import intensive sector with export orientation, raw gems are imported, after finishing they are exported. It also requires high working capital. Paisa bhi chahiye hota hai iske liye. Recent budget announcement are expected to help in this direction. The decision to create a special notified area will help bring diamond trading into India. Special notified area is being created that enable diamond trading in India. Please don't disturb in class. Please, please, this is not good. Please, you go out. Wow. Please don't disturb it. Natural resource based export. Natural resource based export. Now, natural resources also play a very important role. Natural resources also, basically certain exports like basically agriculture and arid activities, like basically marine products, like plantations, they also constitute an important part in export. So in natural based exports, this is another focus area, basically because this category is very important in India. 48% of the labor force is employed in agriculture and allied activities. Basically, this category includes agriculture, plantation crops, marine products, isn't it? There is tremendous potential for export in this sector. In fact, the government is focusing on this sector with mega food processing park and cold storage chain projects to address the infrastructure issues. Basically, government is focusing on natural based product, that is agriculture and allied products, by way of mega food processing parks एंड कोल्ड बेसिकली कोल्ड स्टोरेज चेन प्रोजेक्ट्स. नाउ दिस इशू व्हाई इट बिकम्स सो इंपॉर्टेंट आई विल डिस्कस, बिकॉज इन इंडिया अमंग द फार्मर एज वेल एज इन ट्रेडर्स देयर इज अ जनरल टेंडेंसी टू डिस्पोज ऑफ द एग्रीकल्चर गुड्स इन देयर रॉ फॉर्म विदाउट एनी वैल्यू एडिशन. वही आलू 2 रुपए किलो बेच देते हैं, वो आलू सड़ जाएगा. एंड द सेम पोटैटो इज परचेज बाय अंकल चिप्स एंड इट सेल्स एट 200 रुपीज पर केजी. द सेम पोटैटो इज आफ्टर वैल्यू एडिशन इज सोल्ड बाय अंकल चिप्स एट 200 रुपीज केजी. द सेम इज डिस्पोज ऑफ बाय इंडियन फार्मर एट 2 रुपीज केजी. देयर इज लैक ऑफ वैल्यू एडिशन इन इंडियन एग्रीकल्चर. This value addition would have led to establishment of number of agro-based industries, and that would have created further employment and as well as increase in the earning. Are you getting this? And without value addition, basically what we are selling, we are simply selling the raw, basically in raw form. And our agriculture sector has never emerged as a lucrative profession. कभी कोई शौक से नहीं कहता मैं agriculture करूँगा बड़ा होके. After my graduation, I will become a farmer. Nobody says. Why? Because agriculture has failed to emerge as a lucrative profession because of lack of value addition. Now, agriculture products. Export of agriculture and any products, that is including plantation and marine products, have more than doubled over the past 5 years. This export has more than doubled in the past 5 years. Exports have grown from $17.8 billion in 2008-09 to $42 billion in 2013-14. मतलब $18 billion से लगभग $42 billion हुआ है exports from 2008-09 to 2013-14 within a span of 5 years at a compound annual growth rate of 19%. The exports from agriculture and elite sector has increased at a compound annual rate of 20% during 2013-14. Agriculture products export accounted for 13.6% of total export. Socho 2008-09 since 2008-09 to 2013-14 span of 5 years, the export of agriculture and elite products have increased from $17.8 billion to $42 billion. At a compound annual growth rate of 19%, huge, and they account for 13.6% of the total export. Now, important consideration while framing a trade policy for agriculture product, what are? Basically, while framing the agriculture policy, the government should ensure that there are adequate stocks for the domestic, for the peoples. The stocks available in the country are adequate. The food security concerns should be taken into account. Domestic price situation should be taken into account, and for exports, to promote exports, it should be ensured that remunerative prices should go to the producers. While framing this policy, trade policy in agriculture, government need to take into account all these concerns, that is stock availability in the country, second food security concern, domestic price situation, and ensuring remunerative price for the cultivators and price competitiveness in international market. Now, the salient features of a plan of action to promote export of agriculture products we are going to discuss. What are the salient features of the plan of action that has been adopted to promote agriculture export? First salient feature is a stable policy. A stable policy regime maintaining a long term stable consistent, that is fluctuation hota hai bataya tha desh mein kai baar to government aati hai abhi without taking into account the domestic stock we export onion fir yahan par pyaaz khaya ko nahi milta hai it is 80 rupees kg then we again import it are yaar pehle hi dekh lo you should take the stock of the situation. So this the plan, the stable policy regime is stipulated that we maintain a long term stable consistent and by default open export policy. Agriculture sector would be open to export, there would be no restriction. Second, SPS sanitary and phytosanitary measures and technical barriers to trade, these issues will be effectively handled. This includes what to handle these issues, what is required. Two things are there: First, upgrading quality to avoid disruption. First of all, we must upgrade the quality of our agriculture product to ensure that trade is not disrupted on account of sanitary and phytosanitary measures. Our agriculture product should be of adequate quality. Second, we should effectively challenge the unfair trading practices of the trading partner if they are resorting to unreasonable use of sanitary and phytosanitary measure. उसकी आड़ में हमको मतलब इग्नोर कर रहे हैं, हमारा ट्रेड रेस्ट्रिक्ट कर रहे हैं. आइडियली हम अपना प्रोडक्ट की क्वालिटी बढ़ाएंगे सो दैट इट मे नॉट एक्ट एसपीएस मे नॉट एक्ट एज अ बैरियर एंड वी विल आल्सो सी दैट आवर ट्रेडिंग पार्टनर डज नॉट यूज एसपीएस मेजर एज बेसिकली इन इम्प्रॉपर वे टू रिड्यूस टू चेक आर एक्सपोर्ट्स. व्हाइल इंडिया basically is now a significant supplier of agricultural products. Yes, globally India is a significant supplier of agricultural products to the world. But this remains largely confined to commodities like cereals, groundnuts, castor oil, oil meals, gorgum, etc. Basically, these surpluses are limited in India. So we have to ensure that we have adequate surplus. Whatever we are exporting, we should have adequate surplus. So the supply side issues need to be ensured. We need to enhance their production. Thus, these commodities which we are exporting, like cereals, groundnuts, castor oil, oil meals, we are having limited surplus. So we need to address the supply side concerns. Secondly, there should be shift in focus towards processed and value-added exports. Towards processed and value-added export. We told you, 2 rupees ke aloo and 200 rupees ke uncle chips. The same potato they purchase from us and resell us at 200 rupees in the form of uncle chips. So there is need, and this also hinders generation of employment in agro-based industry. Second, we need a range of facilities in the form of infrastructure. 30% of the food grain get destroyed because of lack of adequate storage facilities. India ka 30% food grains get destroyed. Why? Every year. Because we don't have high quality storage facilities. So we need a range of facilities and infrastructure on post-harvest. Post-harvest means after harvesting, how to protect them. We need cold storage chain facility and transport logistic from farms to ports. The ports should be connected to farms so that the produce can be easily exported. We need to have silos with temperature control mechanism to preserve the quality. Just a minute.